Good morning. Welcome to King's Church. If you'd like to stand, we're going to praise our great God. Our God who created the world. Our God who sent his Son to die for us. our voices again, sing those words.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art!
How great thou art!
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art!
And when we think of God's greatness, isn't it amazing that we can call God Father? Some words from Galatians chapter 4. God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba Father, so that you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are His child, God has made you also an heir.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, He's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Very good morning to you. Please do sit down. Welcome to King's Church Chessington. My name is Gareth Edwards. If you are new here, a special welcome to you. Please make yourselves known to us at the end of the service. And a very special welcome to friends and family of Alan and Fiona, of Matt and Nicola that are here with us. They are dedicating themselves to raising Jack, Joel, Austin. Sorry, Jack, Joel, and Austin. Not Jack, Joel, Austin. Jack, Joel, and Austin today. So we are so thrilled that you could spend the day with us. If you're new here, let me just explain roughly what we'll be doing. We're going to pray in a minute. Then we're going to ask the families onto stage. We're going to do a little service of dedication. Then we've got another song. We've got a reading. Our senior pastor, Mike Tyndall, is going to come and explain that passage to us. So nothing weird. But we are thrilled that you can be here with us. Let's pray together. So please quieten your hearts and your minds and join me in prayer. Father God, we want to stop. We want to pause. We want to bow our heads and our hearts before you. And we acknowledge the truth written in James 1, verse 17. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Father, we thank you for your good gifts, the good gifts that we have noticed today, and the many good gifts that we haven't. Thank you that you've shone your good gifts on us, even in those two songs that we sung. I am who you say I am. We thank you for your unchanging nature. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You are dependable. You are a good, good Father. You alone give birth, truth, life to your creation. Please give us life through your word, the Bible, today. Help us to see Jesus, the Good Shepherd. And lead us in your ways, we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask for the parents and kids to join me on stage. That's the parents being dedicated and the kids that are being dedicated, not all of you. So we're going to have a few people coming forwards. And I've asked the dads if they can introduce us to the people that are coming. So we've got Alan and Fiona coming. We've got Matt and Nicola coming. And these couples have come this morning to publicly give thanks for the safe arrival of their children and to dedicate themselves to raise them as Christians, what the Bible terms the fear and understanding of the Lord. And it's a good thing that we're doing here. It's also good that we're doing this in front of the congregation, but also members of their family and friends. So, Alan, do you want to go first, introduce us to these bundles of fun.
Yes, my name is Alan Mugumia. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're on.
And Fiona is my wife. This is Joel.
Hello, Joel.
And Jack.
Hello, Jack. How are you doing?
Yeah.
Thank you for joining us today. Matt, your turn.
So I'm Matt. This is my wife, Nicola. So I'm Roman, Mason, and Austin.
Fantastic. Good to see you. What do you think of it up here? Five boys. What a five-a-side team this would make. Hey? We'll have to make that happen one day. Okay, we're going to move to the formal bit now. I'm going to read a passage from the Bible, which you'd find in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 to 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commands that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and of your gates. And we have three questions, two to the parents here and one to you guys. Don't miss your big part in this And it is a very important part. But listen to what they're promising, and then you'll notice what you're promising. So, it's quite a long question, just to warn you. With the Lord's help, will you promise to provide a godly example to your children and model the Christian life before them, teaching them the Bible in your home, modeling it as to what it means to repent and believe in the Lord Jesus, and praying regularly that these guys might one day come to trust the Lord Jesus for themselves? Just before you answer, I'm going to give you a warning and these guys a warning that the right answer is, with the Lord's help, we will. Just in case you didn't get a chance because of these guys to read all the promises through this morning. So we're going to say after three, one, two, three, with the Lord's help, we will. Fantastic. Question two. Will you seek to provide a home for your children pervaded by the truth of the gospel, where the truth is spoken in love, the forgiveness of sins is enjoyed, godly hospitality is shared, honesty and integrity set the tone, and your desire is for the children to call God their heavenly Father in the power of the Spirit? One, two, three. With the Lord's help, we will. Fantastic. And this is to you guys, to the church at King's Church Chessington, members of the wider family and their friends, will you welcome these children into your friendship, into your family? Will you promise to seek to care for these parents and their children and provide a Christian environment both in your homes and here in church so that these kids will experience a family where the Lord Jesus is loved and served with reverence and joy, and where in God's grace they might come to trust in Christ for themselves? And after three, one, two, three, we all say, with the Lord's help, we will. That was sort of 80% on enthusiasm there. You can model the extra 20% with what you do about it. Fantastic. We're going to try and stand still while Val Archer, who's known well by both families, comes to pray for these kids in the awesome responsibility that they have just promised their lives to.
Well, will you join me as we pray for these lovely families? Our loving Heavenly Father, what a joy it has been to see these two families come together to seek your blessing on their young boys this morning. We bless you that you have had these precious families in your heart since before the foundation of the world. Before you created anything, you loved these families. And because you're the author of life, in your good time, you gave Jack and Joel to Alan and Fiona, and Roman, Mason and Austin to Matt and Nicola. How we thank you for giving these parents the faith to believe and receive the gift of salvation that you so generously and lavishly pour on each one of us. You offer this gift of salvation, and you've shown them that life lived without you is futile. So we do pray especially for Matt and for Alan in the awesome responsibility that they have to be strong, loving fathers as they lead their families in the ways of God, relying on their Heavenly Father for all strength and wisdom. And we ask that you will give Fiona and Nicola all the patience, stamina, and love as they daily care for their little chaps, modeling their total dependence on you. Bless them in their marriages, that amidst the challenges and chaos of family life, they will stay close to one another as they grow in your word and your ways. May they be quick to apologize and always point their boys to the Good Shepherd, who is full of goodness and love, and will lead them all the days of their life. And we pray, Father, that you'll give them the greatest desire of their heart, not to have a good education or successful careers, but that these little chaps from their earliest days will have soft hearts to the Saviour, that in their day and generation they may be strong men of God, seeking to please and love you and serve you all of their days. We thank you for the godly grandparents who support their families, for Alice and Margaret in Uganda, and Jennifer and David and Jane nearer to home in the vital role they play as they prayerfully support their family and their grandchildren. Father, we know that we love these children so much that we brought to you this morning, and we covet your blessing on each one of them, whilst recognising the huge responsibility that there is in parenting when we so desperately need the help of the Spirit of one another and the church family. So as a church, may we be faithful in loving, caring and faithfully supporting in prayer these young families and youth workers in this church as we seek to show and tell the gospel, which is the greatest news in all the world. And indeed, we pray that you'll be with the children as they go out now. Bless them and their leaders alike for the honor of your name and the glory of Christ Jesus in this area of Chessington and beyond. And we ask this in the strong and precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Val. Thank you, you guys. You are now able to go and sit down again. Thank you so much for coming up. Yes, let's give them a round of applause. Now, as Val referred to in her prayer, raising kids to know about Jesus is a partnership with the parents, a partnership with the church. We're going to express that partnership as we stand to sing our next song. This is how we're going to express it. There are groups available, parents, for 0 to 11-year-olds. They're available at the back, and you need to find someone with a yellow lanyard. It's very hard to get your mouth around a yellow lanyard. But they're available at the back. Our partnership with you is that you can take your kids to them, register in a safe environment for them to hear about Jesus, and you can come back in the service and hear about him. After this song, then Elform is going to come and bring us our reading, and then Mike's going to come and explain that part of the Bible to us. So let's stand and sing, and parents, you can find the Access to Youth Work at the back.
Anyone needs a Bible, please raise your hands. Someone will bring you one. Today's reading can be found on page 1076 of the Church Bibles. 1076. Very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheepfold. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice. And there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. The Jews who heard these words were again divided. Many of them said, "He is demon-possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him?" But others said, "These are not the sayings of a man possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?" Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts, walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered round him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." I'll just say a quick prayer for Mike as he comes to lead us. Heavenly Father, thank you for our service today and for the message we're about to hear. We come before you to ask that your word will dwell in us richly. Please give Mike the clarity and wisdom he needs to deliver your word to us, Father. We pray that the good news of this message will open our hearts and we will draw closer to you, our Father, living lives that glorify you every day. Amen.
Well, thank you so much, Elle and Gareth and musicians. It's been wonderful already this morning, and a special, again, welcome to friends and family of the Hooks and the Mugumyas. It is really great to have you here on this special day. As you've heard, I'm Mike. I'm one of the pastors here. And what we do now at this point is we have a message based on the Bible, and I will open that passage up for us. So hope you're sitting comfortably. Let me start with a question. If you could be any animal, what would you be? Now, this is a really fun question. Matt, Nicola, Alan, Fiona, this is one you can spend many hours with your boys. When my boys were younger, they loved to ask this. So on one occasion, we asked them, "Okay, if you could be any animal, what would you be?" And my oldest boy, Will, had some friends with him, and they quickly replied, "A lion, a falcon, a llama." Llamas are really good at spitting, by the way, just in case you... then our son James replied, I'd like to be a centaur. I think at this point he was kind of in a mythological stage. Centaurs are strong, they're fast, and they look really cool. And at that point, our youngest was called Ted. We had another one later. And he thought for a moment, and he said, an orca whale. We said, that's interesting. Why would you want to be an orca whale? He replied, because it's the top of the food chain. Nobody eats the orca whale. Setting out his future as a possible chief executive or psychopath. So if you could be any animal, what would you choose? Now, it's interesting. Nobody ever says sheep. Nobody ever says sheep. Why do you think that is? Well, just think about sheep. I mean, they're kind of pathetic, aren't they? You know, sheep, I mean, they're not known for their intelligence. They're not known for their leadership prowess. You know, they're good for eating. I don't know what else they can do. They can't really guard your house. My previous church up in Manchester, we did have a young lady who grew up in a farm in Northern Ireland, and they actually had a sheep that was a pet. This sheep actually thought it was a dog. It would run out and kind of greet her and stuff like that. But you know, sheep, they're not really good for much. And yet, through the whole Bible, the main image that's used for God's people is sheep. We're like sheep. The prophet Isaiah famously said, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. We've turned each of us to our own way, as sheep tend to do. Or the psalm writers, here's Psalm 95, verse 6 and 7. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. See the image? Now, I wonder if many of you would know Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. There it is again, the idea of a sheep. Because along with this image of people as sheep is another image that is the king or the leader is the shepherd. I'm going to read a well-known Christmas carol reading. If you've ever been to a Christmas carol service, you've almost guaranteed to have heard this bit of the Bible. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, although you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. And here's how that verse carries on. He will stand, this ruler will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely. So there's the image again of the great ruler, the king, who will stand, and what does he do? He shepherds his flock in strength. So you see how these two images come together. The idea of the sheep, people as the sheep, and the ruler as the shepherd who protects them and provides for all their needs, pasture. Now, because God in the Bible is more than anything a great king. That's the main image in the Bible for God is the great king. God too is spoken of as a shepherd. Psalm 23, which I mentioned, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. There you have the shepherd and the sheep again, this time applied to God himself. Psalm 80, hear us. This is a prayer. Hear us, shepherd of Israel. You who lead Joseph like a flock. Now you say, okay, sheep, shepherds, that's interesting. Sort of. But so what? What does this actually mean for me on Monday morning? Does it say anything to me about my life? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Because this Bible imagery is absolutely central and vital for our lives. I've actually come to the conclusion that this teaching contains truth that is so beautiful, it is absolutely necessary for us to grasp it today, especially actually on a Thanksgiving day, where we think about children and we make promises to commitments to them for their future. This truth is vital. I want to try and persuade you today, no matter what your faith commitments right now. I want to try and persuade you that you being a sheep and God being your shepherd is the best news you could hear. It's such good news that the Bible writers come back to it again and again and again. So what is it that they're trying to tell us that's so important for our lives? Here it is. The Lord is our only comfort. The Lord God is our only comfort. Jesus is our only comfort. Now, why do I say only? Isn't that an overstatement? Surely there are other things that comfort us as well. I'm sure you can think of plenty. And there are plenty of things that bring us comfort, but the Lord God is the ultimate comfort, the one that trumps all the others. The Bible teaches that Jesus Christ can be a comfort to us to such an extent that we can speak of him as the only one because nothing else compares. And more than that, actually, you might never have thought about this, but there is not a single good comfort that we enjoy that does not have its source, its origin, and its sustenance from the good God. Whether it's a loving partner, or a warm home, or a fine friend, or a delicious bar of chocolate. Comfort comes from God. Here's how an old definition of the Christian faith, which was written in Heidelberg in Germany in 1563, put it. What is your only comfort in life and death? That I, with body and soul, both in life and death, am not my own, but I belong to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. The Lord is our only, our greatest comfort. We need him, and when we have him, he is enough. And without him, we're just adrift like a small boat tossed on the waves of the ocean, or like sheep without a shepherd. Now, this is the main point, as I've said, of our passage today. I want us to grab that. The Lord is our only comfort. And I want to just briefly set this story, this passage where Jesus teaches about sheep and the shepherd in its context. So chapter 9, which came right before, told the story in depth of a man who was born blind, and Jesus came to him and had a conversation with him and healed him, put some spat on the ground, put some mud on his eyes, told him to go a distance, half to three quarters of a mile away, and wash his sockets of his eyes. And this man, who was congenitally disabled, a birth defect of blindness, had his sight fully restored to 20/20 vision. And it's an extraordinary miracle, powerful story in its own, on its own right. It's a story of healing. But the real point of that story was that that man is being presented to us as a model of faith. Showing us what faith is like. And we learned last week that faith is given, just like Jesus gave sight to that man. Faith is given to those who know they're blind. Faith also trusts Jesus and obeys him, even when it looks ridiculous. And faith then sees the love and the power of Jesus Christ. Now, that was last week. Here in chapter 10, we are shown the nature of that faith relationship with Jesus. What is its dynamic? What's the logic? What's the kind of, how does it work, this faith relationship that Jesus Christ calls us into? And I want to just say a few things that biblical faith is not. Especially if you're a skeptic here. You know, maybe you came because somebody invited you. You're really not sure about Christianity or any religion or God for that matter. But you're here. And we're glad you're here. And let me just point out three things that biblical faith is not. Firstly, it's not blind faith. The Bible never invites you to close your eyes and just trust something that you know is ridiculous. Okay? The Bible says, God says in the Bible, come, let us reason together. The Bible is a book that invites you to reason. It's not blind faith. And so the Bible is also not inviting us to faith that is just an emotional experience. Now, I'm not saying emotions aren't important. Of course they are. The Bible values us as whole people. Body, soul, mind, intellect, emotions, all of that, will. We're a whole person. But faith is not merely emotional. you know, I just need this thing, so I'm going to just grab onto it, and then, oh, maybe I'll have an experience. It's not that, although it might include that, but faith fundamentally is not that. Neither, opposite end of the spectrum, is faith just about giving mental assent to data from the past. Now, as I said, the Bible addresses us to reason, it addresses our mind, our intellect, but it's not merely a matter of you agreeing to certain facts, certain data from the past, and that's faith. Faith is more than all those things, because biblical faith is trust, reasoned trust in Jesus Christ and entering into a relationship with him that is living. It's a bit of a mouthful, so let me say it again. Biblical faith is trust in Jesus and entering a relationship with him. And chapter 10 is showing us the nature of that relationship. Okay? Jesus is helping us here. He doesn't give us a lecture, he gives us a picture. He doesn't give us a theory, he gives us an image. And the image is really simple. It's the image of sheep and a shepherd. Sheep and a shepherd. And I've got 3 points today which are coming up here, and they all begin with sure. Okay? Sheep, shepherd, and sure, the sure promise of God. I had to come up with something, guys, right? But at least you might remember it. Sheep. Now, I don't know much about sheep from personal experience. Do you? I don't see many sheep wandering around Chessington. I rarely see a lamb that isn't already cooked. And we don't have many shepherds in the room. Correct me afterwards. Somebody back there with a big crook, you know. So when we come to an image in the Bible like sheep, we can be tempted to go into free association mode. Whoa, we think of some things we know about sheep. I heard this thing about a sheep once, and then we sort of import that into the Bible text. This kind of thing is a danger of group discussion. If you've ever been in a group discussion about a Bible text, someone might say, well, I like to think of sheep as, fill in the blank, being helpless. You know, they need to be helped off the ground. Now, I just want to share a basic principle of hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is a fancy word. My dad used to say that hermeneutics played midfield for the Netherlands in the 1970s. Hermeneutics is the science of interpretation. How can we rightly interpret a text, any kind of text? And so people who study the Bible talk about hermeneutics and principles. And here's one principle that's really important. And actually, when you hear it, you'll know that it's really straight, it's really obvious. The text must govern our understanding of the image. What we've got here governs our understanding of the image, not our background knowledge. This is helpful for us today because there's lots of things about sheep that Jesus isn't talking about, so they don't apply. Sheep smell. This doesn't mean that God's people smell, all right? Sheep have ticks. Just thinking about it makes you itchy, doesn't it? Sheep need an annual shearing. Maybe that's a good point for some of us here. I've just been sheared this week. Got no beard crackle on this today. Sheep are not very intelligent. None of those things, Jesus is not talking about any of them, but he does point out two things in the text, two things in the passage, and this is that sheep are vulnerable and sheep follow. They are vulnerable and they follow. Look at verse 10 with me. John 10, verse 10 says this. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. Now, the thief here is not interested in building up the flock. The thief comes in, he's only interested in money and kebabs. What chance do the sheep have when a thief comes? Then in verse 12, it is another image. The hired hand is not the shepherd, and he doesn't own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. The wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. A wolf is one of the most savage images, isn't it, in nature. It's a powerful threat. It's menacing. What chance does a sheep have against a wolf? You're never going to bet on the sheep winning, are you? They are vulnerable. On their sheep, on their sheep. On their own, sheep are terribly vulnerable. They really are. And secondly, sheep, their nature is to follow. They follow. Now, in verses 3 and 4, you notice that sheep have a choice and willpower. Look at verse 3. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice, but they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him. So sheep aren't completely thick. You know, they have choice, they have willpower, they listen, they have knowledge, they recognize things. But the emphasis throughout the passage is that these creatures need a leader. They need someone else to look after them, to provide direction, or they will choose the wrong path. They will tend to stray and get scattered and then be in great danger. So the picture of sheep here is that they are easily lost. Okay? Two things emerge from Jesus' presentation of sheep. They are vulnerable and they need to follow. Now that is not how we like to think of ourselves, is it? I don't like to think of myself as vulnerable and needing to someone to help me lead me. I like to think that I'm strong and I'm autonomous and I can do a pretty good job of taking care of myself. I'm reasonably capable, somewhat self-reliant. I like to think I'm the captain of my own destiny. I think we all do, but not according to the Bible. The Bible's diagnosis of us, all of us, is that we're actually vulnerable and we are followers. And you can see this, you know this. You ever noticed how different tribes of people all dress the same? Remember this from maybe from school. There's one group who are the nerds. The nerds all dress the same, they look the same, they're into the same stuff. Then there's the goths. The goths listen to the same kind of music, they're all wearing black, they've got this kind of makeup on. They kind of got this thing. Then there's the jocks, the sporty ones. There's different tribes, but they all tend to clump together. You ever noticed, you ever wondered why when people want to be alternative, they tend to dress the same as other alternative people? You know, the same is true in the realm of ideas. People tend to follow. Even when they are free thinking, they tend to be free thinking along certain free thinking lines. See, we are creatures of imitation. We're followers by nature. And our culture has led us down certain paths. One of the most trodden ones is the path of materialism. Materialism, this was supposed to be a very satisfying pasture. Get the house, the dream house, the forever house. Get the car, or maybe two cars, or maybe a car and a vintage car. Get the holidays. Get the stuff. But we don't find that materialism is actually satisfying deeply, do we? Not deep down. It has not answered our needs. We yearn for something more. And then there's the path of self-definition. Our culture has told us that we will only be satisfied if we define ourselves. We find our own deepest desires by looking within. And we define ourselves and our own identity. This is me. This is who I am. Let it go, let it go. You know that song, Frozen? Anyone here who had a daughter a few years ago will have heard it. That song is all about how you look down inside, you see who you are, and you don't let anyone tell you. You choose. But this path is contradictory and crushing. It's contradictory because when I look into my heart, I find that I'm a creature whose desires are conflicting. And it's crushing because when I seek to define myself, I'm under huge pressure to be someone. Probably the best explanation of this I've read came from Madonna. Madonna gave an interview to Vogue magazine. And she said this is astonishing. If you think about Madonna, one of the most successful people, artists of her generation, she said, my drive in life comes from a fear of being mediocre. That is always pushing me. I push past one spell of it, and I discover myself as a special human being. But then I feel I am still mediocre and uninteresting unless I do something else. Because even though I have become somebody, I still have to prove that I am somebody. My struggle has never ended, and I guess it never will. It's Madonna. You know, there is a better path than materialism or self-definition. It is a very surprising one, and it is subversive. And actually, it's probably offensive to some of us. It's to say this: the Lord is my shepherd, I'm a sheep, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. So the first step on the road to comfort is to admit that you are a sheep. And that takes humbling. It's not what I want to think about myself. It's not what I wanted to hear. But it is what I needed to hear. And friends, this morning, there is no comfort for you in Jesus Christ as long as you believe that you are your own Lord and Savior, that you are independent and self-defining. Jesus' comfort can only be received by those who are humbled and acknowledge and realize, I need you, Lord. Those who acknowledge that and say, Lord, I confess, I'm vulnerable, I need to follow you. See, the life of faith is a relationship of trust. And we're thinking about the nature of that relationship, and the first thing we've learned is that I'm a sheep. So, friends, who are you going to choose to follow this week? Whose voice will you listen to? Who can lead you to safety and satisfaction? Who will give you ultimate protection and provision? There's nobody else, because he is the shepherd. Second point, shepherd. Jesus is the good shepherd. He says it here, verse 14, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. What kind of shepherd is Jesus? Now again, we're not going to go into freestyle mode here. We might find that interesting, but we wouldn't be enlightened. But this text says a few things about the shepherd. It says that he's a gate. Huh? Yeah. The shepherd is a gate. It says that he's good. And it says that he's God. Three G's. He's a gate, verses 7 to 9. Very truly, Jesus said, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. Verse 9, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved or safe. Now, a gate here is primarily an image of protection. Just kind of imagine the ancient Near East, a long way from streetlights and car parks and roads. The shepherd takes his sheep to a place where they can feed, and then at night, they are at risk, so he brings them into a sheep pen, some kind of enclosure, and there's an entrance there. And what do you think the shepherd uses for the gate in the middle of the wilderness? His own body. The shepherd lies across the gate. Why does he do it? So that any threat will have to come over him, and he'll be there to defend them. And bear in mind, this is written in a country which had bears and wolves and wild creatures of various kinds. This is not a domesticated country. Being the gate is a risky business. Being the gate says, I'm committed to you. I'm there. Anyone or anything coming after the sheep will have to go through him. He is the gate. And verse 9 says, if you go through this gate, Jesus, you will be safe, saved. Jesus is talking about himself. He's the gate. Secondly, he's good. He's the good shepherd. And why is he so good? First of all, he knows you. Verse 14, I'm the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. What a thought that Jesus Christ himself actually knows you. You're known by name to him. This is not just data from the past. We're talking about a living reality. Jesus, who is God eternal, the Son of God, and will live forever, knows you by name. He knows you. He knows everything about you, by the way. Sometimes we think we have to clean up our prayers before we pray. Because we wouldn't want to say things like that to God. God already knows about it. He's good. He knows you and he cares for you. He gives a contrast in verse 12 between the hired hand, who's not the shepherd, and the shepherd himself. The hired hand is just on the payroll, okay? He's got a day rate or an hourly wage. He's doing it for money. And when danger comes, the hired hand runs for the hills. He's not going to lay down his life for the sheep. He will not put himself in danger. He's primarily concerned with his own needs, what he can get out of the sheep. But the good shepherd cares this much. He will lay down his life for the sheep. Now, the obvious meaning of that is he puts himself in danger. But the deeper meaning in this book of John that we're walking through in church at the moment is that Jesus Christ is heading to a final laying down of life at the cross. He knows he's going there. Nobody else knows it at this stage. He keeps referring to it. He says, my hour is coming, or my hour is not yet here. He's going to lay down his life at the cross. So do you, friends, do you see what, are you starting to see what this means? Jesus Christ is so anxious for your salvation that he does not spare anything, even his own life. What kind of shepherd is this? His love for the sheep knows no limits. He will go to any lengths for their good. He will give himself completely. His never stopping, never giving up, unbreaking, always and forever love. So the implication, brothers and sisters, Christian friends here today, whatever is going on in your life right now, he knows about it and he has not changed. Of course, I can't make sense of it all. Maybe we never will till we see him. But he knows about it and he's not changed. He's the gate, he is the good shepherd, and he is actually able to do all this because Jesus is God in the flesh. Remember what we thought about that in the Bible, the shepherd, the greatest shepherd of Israel is God himself. So Jesus saying, I am the good shepherd, has this implication. Now God has become a man, and he's bringing in a flock from all nations around the world. And here in 2024, we are seeing that around the world in ways that would have been unimaginable to the first Christians. We've thought already in John's Gospel, if you've read it, about the nature of Jesus and his relationship with God the Father. Back in the beginning, it says, in the beginning of all things, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. This Word, who is Jesus, is God, and yet he's with God. We're figuring out here the nature of God, which is so rich and complex, it's beyond our understanding, that he is a unity of three persons, Father, Son, and Spirit, a tri-unity, Trinity. And the relationship that Jesus has with the Father is like this: the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in the closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. Jesus Christ, it says literally, is in the bosom of the Father. He's right next to his heart, and he's come to make him known to us. He's come all the way down for you and me. And so here we get the most wonderful insight into the heart of God. Verse 17. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. That verse is actually astonishing. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life. 16th century French reformer John Calvin commented on this. He, Jesus, became man for our sakes, and the Father loved him to the end, or the purpose, that he might reconcile us to himself. Our salvation is dearer to him than his own life. Here is a wonderful commendation of the divine goodness to us, which should ravish our souls into admiration. That God not only extends to us the love due to Jesus, but he ascribes it to us as the final cause. The reason my Father loves me is that I'm doing this for you, says Jesus. Christ himself, who came into the world to be completely obedient to his Father, confirms that in everything, his only aim is to think of us. Amen? Are you feeling it yet? Brothers and sisters, do you have any idea how much God loves you? Do you have any idea of the sheer love and goodness and mercy of this kind shepherd? The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life. Jesus says it. Now, all of this combines to give us actually a completely new kind of identity, if you can put it together. Because if we first of all accept that we're sheep, we accept we're lost, we're vulnerable, we were following the wrong voices, and then we see that he's the shepherd who came down for us, who came all the way down from heaven to earth, who came from life to death, who came from glory to shame, who came from the courtyard of heaven to the cross. We see that Jesus came all that way. We see that Jesus is the gate. He's come to lie down in the way to protect us. He interposes himself between us and danger. No one can get to you without going through him. He's good. He's God incarnate. You're starting to see how this comes together? There's an old hymn called In Tenderness. It's been set to a beautiful modern tune. In tenderness, he sought me, weary and sick with sin. And on his shoulders brought me back to his fold again, while angels in his presence sang, until the courts of heaven rang. Oh, the love that sought me. Oh, the blood that bought me. Oh, the grace that brought me to the fold of God. He is the good shepherd and we are the sheep. And the real world value of this is actually incredible. Because out of this flows commitment. The commitment of Almighty God to you, his people, expressed in sure and steadfast promises. Have a look with me in this third and final point. This is the briefest point. Verses 27 to 30. Look at these sure promises. Verse 27, my sheep, says Jesus, listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. That's a promise. No one will snatch them out of my hand. That's a promise. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. It's a promise. You see what he's saying? Sure and certain words for us, which mean we are safe. We are safe. How do we know this future is secured? Two pairs of hands. Jesus says, no one can snatch them out of my hand. He's got you. And behind him is God the Father. No one can snatch you out of the Father's hand. It means if you're a believer, a follower, a sheep of Jesus, your future is secure. You are safe. Whatever storms may come, you can say, it is well with my soul. Christ has seen you. He knows you, lost, helpless, and wretched. And he set his love on you. So Jesus says to you today, friend, be confident. Live boldly, without fear, for I've got you in my hand. Christian friend here, your salvation is more certain than anything else in the universe. I know your faith is weak. You're prone to wander, aren't you? You're prone to waver and doubt. But this confidence here is not based on anything else, anything in you, but God's promise to you. God has taken your life in his hand. He will not let you go, and he has the power to take you through everything in life and even through death itself and bring you safe into his presence. He will not let you go. Now, many of us will struggle with doubt. It comes with the territory. Some people, though, are almost constitutionally prone to it. It eats them up and it drains their strength. It's like a shadow. I want to say to you, dear doubting friend, is part of the problem that you're looking in too much? You need to look out at the Good Shepherd. Two kinds of people get on an aeroplane. One of them loves flying and loves everything about flying. This person has the app. You know the app? They watch the planes. This person loves finding out about the plane and its history. This person even loves aeroplane food. And so this person is sitting there, even in economy. They're loving it. I love flying. And right next to them is this other person who has got fear of flying, and they're full of doubts and fears. In fact, all that this person can think about is what it would be like if the plane crashed. Maybe you're like that. And there they are, these two people sitting next to each other. One of them, two people on the same plane, one of them is loving it, the other one is full of doubts and makes, you know what? It makes no difference at all to the safe landing, how you feel about it. Because the object of the faith is the same, it's the plane. And if the plane is sound and safe, you're fine. Trust it. Take a deep breath and look away from yourself to the Good Shepherd. And some of us here are distressed. Maybe you're not doubting, but you're just in distress. You know you are. There are all sorts of reasons. Oh, the feeling is awful. You would do anything to get rid of this feeling of distress, this mental torment. Let's ask the question again from the Heidelberg Catechism. What is your only comfort in life and death? That I belong to Jesus Christ, body and soul, life and death. I'm not my own. I belong to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus says he and his Father have got you in their hands, and they are one. We'll have a moment just to reflect, and then we're going to turn this into sung worship. Just a couple of thoughts, though, before we do that. If you're new to all this, but you'd like to explore more, we have plenty of opportunities to do that. One really easy one, actually, is just to come next weekend. We have a Good Friday morning service for all families here at 10:30. And then on Easter Sunday, we have another church service just like this, where we're thinking about Jesus' resurrection. You're most welcome to come back next week, anytime, 10:30, both Friday and Sunday. But if you'd like to take a little step more than that and connect into the life of the church, we're having a lunch soon here, and you get a chance to meet some of our leaders and talk about what it's like to join King's Church, get involved. I've even got a little bookmark with a QR code, which you can take off me and sign up for that lunch afterwards. I'll be out at the front door. But, you know, there might be someone here who actually knows this is the moment to come to the Good Shepherd in prayer for the first time. So let's do that now. I am the Good Shepherd, said Jesus. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for what you revealed to us here about ourselves, which is a true reflection, and what you share with us here, which is a mind-blowing revelation, that though you know us better than anyone else, you loved us to this extent, you laid down your life. And there is perhaps one person in this room who now wants to say, Lord, forgive my sins, accept me. Please, Father, receive him or her now and give them strong courage and confirmation that they are yours. Pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing a couple of songs to finish. Songs about our shepherds who will keep us from now and into eternity. Stand. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's remain standing in the power of Christ and thank him. Father God, we thank you so much for our Lord Jesus. Thank you for the verdict that faith in him gives to our life. Please, as we've just sung, would we stand in that power, not just today, but for the rest of our lives, we pray. Amen. Amen. Please do take a seat. Three brief notices. One is we meet again tonight at 6 p.m. in here for the final in our series on Sunday night. As Mike has already mentioned, we're back Friday next week, the week coming, this Friday at 10:30. And then the following, a week today, Sunday. I'll get it straight. It's holiday season nearly. And please also do stay behind. Enjoy a cup of tea or coffee. It's all falling apart now. It's because the kids have gone. And please do come and say hello to Mike and myself. Let me close by reading two portions of scripture. One of the two we've already read today. John chapter 10, verses 14 and 15. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I now know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." As a fulfillment of Numbers chapter 6, verses 22 to 27, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace." Amen. God bless you.
restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour. It's your breath in our lungs.
For your King.